Resin 3D prints, even though very detailed, are usually not known for their strength. There are so-called tough resins on the market. But how tough are they, and how does their strength compare to regular FDM 3D prints? Let's find out more! Guten Tag everybody, I'm Stefan, and welcome to CNC Kitchen! This video is sponsored in part by Skillshare, more on them later. When 3D printing with photopolymers, or often just called resins, the liquid material is cured by UV light layer by layer. The most common types of such printers are the ones who use a UV laser that is directed by a pair of mirrors, the so-called galvo scanner, and cures the resin at the point where it hits the resin. The other type, which is often falsely called DLP, are actually MSLA printers, so mask stereolithography printers, where the light of a UV lamp is masked by an LCD screen and a whole layer is always cured at once. The Formlabs and PO Poly Muay printers are example for SLA printers, Prusa's new SL1 and in my case the Dest 3D L120 are examples for MSLA printers. The resin for both types are usually quite similar and even cross-compatible. A couple of months ago, PO Poly reached out to me and asked me if I'm interested to try out their new tough resin called Blue, which they have developed together with Shiraya Tech and that sells for $55 per liter on Amazon. Honestly, I'm still not a huge fan of resin printers due to the smell and mess, but got quite interested when I read about their claimed properties. All of the resins I was using in the past were very brittle and I usually don't use 3D printing for figurines or aesthetic parts. I was asking myself if such a resin would make the parts even usable in mechanically demanding applications. In order to find that out, I basically ran the same test that I also usually perform for my FDM materials on the resin and tested tensile strength, impact resistance, stiffness and also my generic test hook in various printing orientations. By the way, if you enjoy these videos, then please leave a like and make sure that you're subscribed to the channel to not miss any of the upcoming investigations. Due to the odor of the resin, I already used the printer only in my basement. The problem is that it's quite cold down there in the winter and I already had issues with other resin printers at the lower temperatures in the past. PO Poly warned me about that and told me that the best printing results can be achieved at temperatures of around 30 degrees Celsius ambient. So besides the resin, they also sent me one of their heating units, which is usually placed in the printing chamber and heats it up to 35 degrees Celsius and then turns off automatically. Since my printer is too small and I can't place it inside, I quickly made an enclosure out of foam board that I put over the machine that keeps it nice and warm. Before each print, I heated up the chamber to a cozy 30 degrees Celsius and then started the print. While printing, I didn't have to run the heater, since the UV LED in the printer produces quite some heat and also curing the resin itself is quite an exothermic reaction, as you can see with the FLIR thermal camera when I hit some resin with UV light. I printed all of the samples as with my filament tests fully dense to analyze the bulk properties. I only hollowed out the test hook and put a lattice structure on the inside so that the wall thickness and the infill ratio matches my FDM parts so I can compare the strength values. This part also had drain holes in order to get the resin out of the internal void. Printing went smooth and I didn't really fiddle around with the exposure parameters that much, since first, I didn't really have a clue what I had to look for, and second, the parameter set for the DES's high temperature resin worked very well to begin with. In terms of layer thickness, I used 0.05 mm, which is very fine for FDM parts, but mid-range for resin prints. During and after printing, a very noticeable smell, almost lemonish, was in the air, which was a bit unpleasant, but that I really started to enjoy, but more like the way you enjoy sniffing permanent marker and is probably equally unhealthy. So make sure you only really use the resin printer in a well-ventilated area. After printing, I washed the parts in an isopropanol container that I put on a magnetic stirrer. I designed a really nice foldable tray with living hinges that I printed in PP and is therefore resistant against the solvent. Always make sure that you wear gloves while handling any resin because it can sensitize your skin and cause allergies. I used the pre-wash for 15 minutes and then put the parts for another 15 minutes in my second cleaner IPA bath. After drying, I stacked them on an electric turntable, heated up my foam board enclosure to 30 degrees Celsius and cured the parts for 15 minutes in there with the use of PU Poly's UV LED panel and my very own nail studio. Halfway in, I mixed the parts up so that everything got evenly cured. The parts turned out with a blue-green color, a slightly matte surface and partly translucent, an appearance I really liked, especially since you can see the inside of the parts. Now let's finally get to the mechanical tests you probably have all been waiting for. But before I talk about the results, let me know in the comments how you think the TOUGH resin does compare to FDM prints. I measured the tensile strength on my DIY universal test machine. The ultimate strength was almost 50 MPa with quite some yielding before failure, which is stronger than ABS and in the range of PETG. The way more interesting thing was that the coupons that were printed standing were just as strong and tough as the lying ones. So contrary to all FDM prints, the part strength of the resin prints is not depending on the printing orientation and they don't seem to be weaker if you load them perpendicular to their layers. The yielding before failure also showed that the TOUGH resin is really not that brittle at all. Next, I checked the bending modulus of the material on my 3-point bending test rig, where I load a flat sample successively with higher loads and measure the corresponding deformation, from which I can then calculate the stiffness, or better, the bending modulus. Here, the material behaved a bit uncommon and after the loading procedure didn't stop at a specific value but slowly creeped. This can also be seen in the hysteresis of the load deformation plot. If anyone knows why this is happening, let me know. Still at the end, the bending modulus turned out to be 2000 MPa, which is similarly stiff or compliant as PETG or ABS. During the impact test, I strike the coupons with a hammer and measure the amount of energy that was absorbed during this process. Here the material didn't turn out to be the strongest, but still 2 or 3 times better than PLA or PETG. Here again, both printing orientations performed equally well, which is really impressive. Especially when taking a look at the brittleness of standard photopolymers, I think that the name TOUGH resin is really well deserved. The last test is a more realistic test sample, where the part is loaded in bending, tension and shear, and where we can compare the strength of the materials in a more practical manner. There are again samples in lying and standing printing orientation. Again with a strength of 51 and 53 kg, the parts were stronger than ABS and just shy of the strength of PETG, PLA or nylon. And in terms of layer adhesion, it outperforms every other filament based 3D print so far. The fully featured test results are, by the way, available for my patrons. Before we get to the summary, some words on today's sponsor Skillshare that helps me, besides my awesome patrons, to spend the necessary amount of time on these investigations. Skillshare is an online learning community for creators with more than 25,000 classes in design, business and more. A premium membership gives you unlimited access so you can join classes and communities to reach your goals for this year. I'm currently looking into replacing the expensive and buggy Adobe Premiere Pro that I use for editing all of my videos with Blackmagic's DaVinci Resolve, and Skillshare provides professional classes to learn very efficiently. Skillshare is super affordable and an annual subscription is less than $10 a month. Join the more than 7 million creators, and if you are one of the first 500 to use the link down in the description, you'll get a 2-month free trial. In summary, I think PU Poly's, or better, Siraya Tech's, and probably also other TOUGH resins are really something well worth taking a look at, with some caveats. The strength really seems awesome, especially the independence of the printing orientation. This could probably be well used as an injection molding replacement. Though temperature resistance is something I haven't looked into yet, since I didn't really feel that happy putting the samples into my oven as I tend to do it with my filaments, though resin prints should probably perform better than the thermoplastics used for FDM prints. Then there is the UV resistance and aging. I have no clue how the material behaves over longer periods of time, especially outside. Painting the parts might help, and maybe this might be something for a future test. And at last, my biggest concern is the smell and the mess of this process, and probably the reasons why I won't be using this material now every day. But this is really something everyone should decide on their own, just make sure you apply the proper safety precautions. So what do you think about this material, and do you prefer resin prints over FDM prints? Let me know your thoughts down in the comments. Thanks for watching, everyone. If you learned something new today, please leave a like and make sure that you're subscribed for future tests. If you'd like to support me with these investigations, consider becoming a patron or use the affiliate links you can find in the description for your next shopping tour. Also, check out my other videos where I did many more 3D printing related studies. Auf Wiedersehen, and I see you in the next one.